man, oh glory, hallelujah. If I die, I'll live again. Oh glory to his name. If I die, I'll live again. Oh glory, hallelujah. I'm sanctified and holy. I'm on my way to glory.
Each and every one is gathered here in his name. We just thank the Lord for the prayers of the saints that lift us up in Jesus' name. So we're going to pray on out and thank the Lord. Following that, we're going to reach out and to Jesus. Amen. Thank the Lord in song as we just bow our heads right now and thank the Lord for his presence. Father, we do thank you for that reach out and touch the Lord type of faith. Father, that delivers healing to us in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for your eternal presence. We thank you, Father, that you indeed are he who alone is worthy to be praised in worship, Father. There's one upon the throne, and we bow to that, to the living name, to the living word of Jesus Christ our Lord. So, Father, we do thank you for your eternal presence. And Lord, be with those that are in recovery, those who have suffered loss, Father. You know the sorrows, but you're a deliverer, Father. And your word is alive in us, now and forevermore. Father, we thank you for the witness of your word that keeps us on the straight and narrow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you, Lord. Thank the Lord that he's with us. Us up. If you all need an excuse to clap your hands, we got a good song for you. Amen. Yeah. I'm going to clap my hands.
I'm going to clap my hands. I'm going to dance and sing. It's the Holy Ghost up that makes the heavens ring. It lifts me up so high.
Trench foot, because they get up out of that trench and go over the top in Jesus' name. Well, bless the Lord. Thank the Lord for the victory language that's in our songs and our prayers and our praises. Amen. You may be seated this time. Brother Bill comes forward. As we know that what the Lord has for us will do us good. In Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Bill.
Amen. God bless Brother Ryan. God bless everyone this evening. For our first selection, we will sing Come Unto Me.
I Hear the blessed Savior calling the oppressed. O ye heavy laden, come to me and rest. Come no longer tarry, I your load will bear. Bring me every burden, bring me every care. Come unto me, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Hear me and be blessed. I am meek and lowly. Come and trust my mind. Come, my yoke is easy and my burden light. Are you disappointed, wandering here and there, dragging chains of doubt and loaded down with care? You unholy feeling struggle in your breast. Bring your case to Jesus, he will give you rest. Come unto me, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Hear me and be blessed. I am meek and lowly. Come and trust my mind. Come, my yoke is easy. Stumbling toward the pit of hell's consuming flame, by the powers of sin, deeply and oppressed. Hear the tender shepherd, come to me and rest.
Of weakness brought distress within. Christ will sanctify you if you'll claim his best. In the Holy Spirit, he will give you rest. Come unto me, I will give you rest.
Take my yoke upon you. Hey.
bride, say, you, come. Amen. God bless you, brother and sister Miriam. The sisters are now going to sing for us, Behold How Good.
Behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. This is what the Lord wants to see and hear, good fellowship among His bride. For it says in the Bible, you see, how can you hate your brother? Love one another, and you will overcome, and you will stand together in unity. Even though we live in this world, we don't have to become part of it, because life has not fellowship with darkness. Let's not let the light go out. When Jesus comes again, He's gonna take the bride with Him. That's why we must all walk in one accord, so that we can turn the power on.
You, sister, for that, and brother Kevin helping out too. That was good. Amen. For our next lecture, we will sing There's Fire on the Mountain.
There's fire.
fine white linen.
There's fire on the mountain you cleanse and purify. There's fire on the mountain,
a coal fell from the altar.
God's fire makes her ready. Oh, Jerusalem, put on your fine white linen. There's fire on the mountain, you're cleansed and purified. There's fire on the mountain,
God dwells among his people.
There's fire on the mountain,
behold the bridegroom coming.
Oh, Jerusalem, put on your fine white linen. There's fire on the mountain,
you're cleansed and purified.
From the altar. There's fire on the mountain,
hold you full and ready.
Oh, Jerusalem, put on your fine white linen. There's fire on the mountain,
you're cleansed and purified.
Amen. God bless you, brothers and sisters. For our next selection, Sister Margot is going to sing for us, Gladness in My Body.
Gladness in my body, gladness in my soul.
It's okay.
Gladness in my body, gladness in my soul,
gladness in my spirit, that's what makes me whole. Through the blood of Jesus, cleansing waters flow, His anointing fire, that's what makes us glow. Walk in victory, not in defeat. Run into battle, never retreat. He is the commander. He gave His life for me. My weapon is His word of truth. Now I am set free. My people have two evils, this is what they do, forsake my living waters and broken cisterns hew. You are my blessed children, I've called you by my name. When you wield the sword of faith, you defeat blasphemous names. Who can measure Jesus' grace, eternal life to see? We are called to walk by faith and live in liberty. Death to this world, death to this flesh, death to the devil, we'll have a new rebirth. We'll rule and reign with Jesus for 1,000 years. We'll have no tempter then, there'll be nothing left of him. So go, my sons and daughters, in my holy name, conquering the foes around you, the world and all its shame. Gladness in my body, gladness in my soul, gladness in my spirit, that's what makes me whole.
Beautiful. God bless you, sisters. And for our next lection, the sisters will sing for us, "He's Leading Me to Glory." God bless you, sisters. Sister Mim on the piano. For our last selection, we will sing living.
Beautiful, beautiful. God bless you, brothers and sisters. And if we'll all stand,
before Pastor Ryan comes to bring forth the word of truth unto us this evening. If you want to follow along, you can turn to page 76 in the blue book. I'm going up.
I'm going up to a higher place.
Think of a better place to spend my eternity. Amen.
Amen.
In Mount Zion's hills. Amen. Thank the Lord. Faith puts us up there in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As we think on these things and as we bless the Lord with all that is within us, Sister Miriam's going to play through for us. As we seek under the Word of God, Father, we thank you for your truth that sets us in higher places, Father. It lifts us up, puts us in the presence of He who is worthy to be praised. Father, we thank you, dear Lord, for all your blessings. Thank you, Lord, most of all, for the gift of life and that more abundantly. Through the name of Jesus, we thank you for a name that's written in the Lamb's Book of Life that endures forever. Father, we thank you for what we have found in that which is so valuable. It's the pearl of great price that you give all you have to obtain it. Father, we thank you for the mighty blessings that flow from the throne of God, now and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Well, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord for his presence. Thank the Lord for those that call upon his name. So brothers and sisters, make their way out. You may be seated. Thank you, Lord. Well, blessed Lord, once more to battle in Jesus' name as we stand for the truth of God. The world and its influences are out there. You know, when I was listening to the brother sing about his yoke is easy and his burden light, you know, there's a whole world out there, whether it's a Christian Sabbath or not, you know, they want to consume their alcohol, you know, and I'm up here on stage thinking, you know, I want to open me up a big old can of Burden Light. and throw it back. Amen. Bless the Lord. This is better stimulation than you ever get out of a can of this world's alcohol. Amen. Thank the Lord. So his burden is light, and his yoke is easy. So bless the Lord. So as we take in the fullness of God, as given and outlined in Scripture, realization comes to us that our hope is in Christ. Even if we hear semi-bad jokes from the pulpit, amen. God's our salvation. He's our hope, who inspired these prayers, prophecies, and testimonies that we read of. And what is written has eternal properties that will never pass away. So we thank the Lord. We have need of those things. And if it stands the test of time, when time shall be no more, and if it's the Lord and if his attributes are within us, as never there that are never beginning and never ending, as much as God is himself, his attributes are the same, well, then it's good, which makes this a perfect work. This gospel story, this Bible, for it gives us the wisdom of the ages that was there as God's companion, his wisdom was, before there were created beings to worship him. And if it gives you the name of Jesus, and if it leads you to the cross, and it gives you a simple formula to follow of belief and confession for salvation, and your name gets recorded in the book, well, that's a perfect work, because the life of Christ was given for just that end result, that all would come to him for life, and that more abundantly, with added blessings from above. So it's written for God's glory, this scripture is, and it's there for all to see, which is our title phrase for the afternoon and on into the evening time, for all to see. For all to see, as the Lord himself, the very Spirit of truth, has made his presence known to us and revealed everything that's in his heart as concerning his will and his way. There are secrets yet to behold. Sometimes the scripture in the Psalms calls them dark sayings, not to the intent that there's any darkness within the sayings of the Lord, but that they're kept secret and hidden until the time of revealing. But he's revealed his will and his way, and the heart, of course, being figurative, is of being in the middle of God's purpose, in the middle of his being and his divine purpose. So if God is an omnipresent spirit, and he is, because where can you go where there's no Spirit of truth there? God will find you. The Spirit of truth will find you. As David the psalmist said, even if I made my bed in hell, behold, you're there. Well, that means you're always in the center of his will and his dominion. And when God, Jehovah God, as we sometimes call him in English, Yahweh in the Hebrew, El Shaddai, which means Lord God Almighty, when he seated Adam dominion over the work of his hands, then placed us as a race of humanity, when he placed us into the most vital place there is to be, which is right here, amen, and that extends far beyond the physical. We're in the spiritual place and in the center of his will. And thank the Lord. And for sure, the meek shall inherit the earth. So when you hear, I am meek and lowly, it's not taking credit to ourselves. It's just acknowledging that God has put us in this place, amen, to learn and grow in his word. And it doesn't stop there. For the meek inherit the earth, those that are humble in God's sight, doesn't mean timid. They're spiritually audacious, amen. They reach forward to the truth that's set before them. But they're meek and lowly and humble in spirit, which gives us an inheritance. It extends to even this far in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 2, that, beloved, now are we the sons of God. Quite a status that's reserved for us, that not even angels can attain unto, even though they are created greater in power and might than we are. So we can be sons of God. Sons, that's used within Scripture, referring to both genders as representing the entirety of the human race, as the woman was taken from the man. Therefore, sons, when used in that context, represents all the children of God, whether male or female. And the Word was made flesh to dwell among us, to deliver that word and give us newness of life. As the Creator himself put him his position a little bit lower than the angels to declare his substance for all to see. He's there on full display, the righteousness of Almighty God, to make himself known by experiencing life as we do in Christ. And it's made plain as day by Scripture. And that is an amazement. How can an eternal, infinite, non-physical being understand life as we do? Well, Christ is your answer. God has an answer for all these things. Amen. And that was within the birth of Christ, there was divinity. When you go back through the narrative and the Luke chapter 1 and 2 witness of how Christ was born and those things, there was divinity from the start as the power of the Holy Ghost overshadowed one Mary, espoused to Joseph. Therefore, she became the vessel that was meet for use, that was good to the purpose. She was meet for use in the hands of the great potter at the wheel, who will reshape the clay to fit the need of the moment. And that act makes the Holy Ghost to be one with the Father above. It's a oneness scripture, as that's the Spirit within, because as you remember, Mary was told the power of the Holy Ghost will overshadow you. It'll bring forth life. So that makes the Holy Ghost as being part of the Father's nature above. One God, three great attributes, and his blessings go out from there. That act makes the Holy Ghost to be one with him, and it makes Jehovah God of the Old Testament to become embodied in Jesus Christ of the New Testament. But not limited to the body, because God is always an omnipresent spirit. Now, to explain an omnipresent spirit, I've never actually been one. That is a real challenge. We have to use the scriptures and lift up our understanding in that way. But God was within Christ 100%, but still an all-encompassing presence. If our bodies are our universe, so to speak, I'm out here in my little finger. Okay, I'm there, but I'm centered here. So Jesus was the finger of God, because in him we live and move and have our being. We're always inside him, so that's just an extension of the Almighty God's will, who concentrated himself in that form, that physical form, to come among us. But he is always who he is. You can't limit truth just to a physical body. Truth exists everywhere. And wherever light is found and wherever truth is found, God is there. So the mysteries of God, they are truly astounding. But Jesus was born not as the start of an existence. In the physical sense, yes, it started with the birth in Bethlehem, only the physical part. But that's not the start of the existence, but rather it's a continuation of one. Experiencing a physical birth not at the beginning of a life, but in the middle of one, in the middle of an eternal life. And all those memories are within the Father right now. Just somewhat comparable that all the memories that you hold within from your 10-year-old self or your 20-year-old self, however many years you've come to live upon the face of the earth, those memories are always a part of you right now. So it is that everything that Jesus experienced is part of the Father right now, as he's the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 9. It takes revelation to get down to the essence of who God is, but he is one and manifested himself, and he's put everything on the line for us. He's put his divine character on display to declare the love wherewith he loved us. And it's spiritually, I use the word a couple times today, I'll find another word, but for now it'll suffice. It's spiritually audacious, and yet at the same time it's very humble that Christ was born. As the Messiah messenger himself came into us through the form of a servant. Though he was Lord of all, he was those things, but yet born in such a humble manner. No room at the inn. The Almighty God, the I Am, who spoke to Moses out of the fire, stayed obedient to his nature and the humbleness, and even endured the cross to verify everything that was written of him. He did that for us. For his name's sake, yes, but for our benefit as well. Let's turn to Ephesians chapter 3. As Christ stayed obedient to the suffering of the cross in order to fulfill his word so that his name would be glorified, so that we would be glorified thereby. He had to stay true to who he was in order to be holy, holy, holy. The Lord of the harvest had to stay true to himself. And this quote, before we read in Ephesians 3, this quotation is not part of Scripture, but it's a Shakespeare quote. But this above all, to thine own self be true. And that is exactly what the God of heaven intended to do. He was going to be true to his own nature, to be himself. Who was he? The Spirit of truth. So he stayed true to that nature in all his prophetic words and everything that we have written in those red letter words that proclaim the word of the Lord and the sayings of Jesus. So here in Ephesians chapter 3, as to declaring the mysteries of God, in Ephesians 3, we'll pick it up at verse 5. It's Paul speaking and as being the prisoner and of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles. Now, Paul had been an actual prisoner at times in his life. Being a prisoner for the Lord, there's never been a man so free as when you're a prisoner for the sake of the Lord and you have freedom to move within him, within his being, and be made known the revelation and the mysteries of that are there in verse 3, which bring us down to verse 5, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as to Christ coming in a body of flesh. The promise was there, but the fulfillment awaited, but it came. After many long centuries, after many millennia of time, and so now we wait for the coming of the Lord once again. It's been many centuries, it's been two millennia, but we wait patiently because God does not account time, doesn't look at it the way we see it. So these things are in our near future spiritually. How many years it might take to play out? Well, bless the Lord. That's the Lord's decision. He knows. So in other ages it wasn't known. As it is, second part of the verse, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs. Well, here we are. We're all Gentiles in this church. Maybe somewhere down the line of descendancy that leads back to our ancestors, there might be some Jewish blood in there somewhere. But we're out of the nations, so that the Gentiles should be co-inheritors or fellow heirs, and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. And that makes us equal. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, reserved a place, amen. There's a place at Hotel Hallelujah for you to check right on in there, amen. We've got a reservation made in Jesus' name. We're partakers of the promise by the gospel, whereof Paul, who, as he thought upon what a life this guy lived. Boy, if you had a life like Paul, such things that he saw and how his life got turned around. He was going one way for all his life, a Pharisee's poster child, so to speak, as we'd put it in modern terminology, very zealous according to the law of Moses, right down to the over-interpretations of the small matters of the law. But now he's completely something else. Well, bless the Lord. And he's made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. How does God's power work? Effectually. It has great effect. It does things. Amen. Unto me, who am less than the least of all the saints. Now, he was, we account him as a first church age messenger and the founding, the vessel that God used to be the founder of the Gentile church and to further it and so forth as the message went out into the isles of the Gentiles, the nations of the world. But he considered himself, he was lowly in his spirit. even though he was in a vaunted position, for sure, as being in charge of the early church and being the witness to the Gentile churches, unto me, who am, he considered himself the least of all, is this grace given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. Unsearchable, that you can't get to the end of it, nor can you divine the will of Almighty God just by intellectual surmisings, as if God was some type of science book. There's science within the Bible, but it's a spiritual book. It's a faith book. That's its primary purpose. And you can't search the riches of Christ without help. So without help from above, his word, there's no end to it. It's unsearchable by human means. Thank the Lord that the simplistic nature of what God has given is benefit to us all. But the deep mysteries of God await. So with revelation, these things are made known. But without that, you can't get to where you need to be in Christ Jesus without some help from above. And that, to this purpose, and to make all men, underscore all, whether Jewish or Gentile, see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Amen. All things created were through the name of Jesus. He's in there. One God, one faith, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. So to make all see out of the nations, Paul serves notice. He's born of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin, but he serves notice of his mission to the Gentile church. And if anyone needed sight along the way, well, as you well know, the gospel story, it was Saul of Tarsus who persecuted the first and second generation church, the people of the way, this way, you know, that way that they have, you know, said derisively there initially as the church began to spread out. Well, Saul got turned around on the road to Damascus, and boy, he reached a crossroads in his life, literally and figuratively. There on the road to Damascus, he never expected that. Who better, though? The Lord had a place for him. Who better to get things turned around than to show Saul of Tarsus where he was errant, as the place of his destiny in that moment would help fuel the conversion of the Gentiles. For it says to make all men see. You have to see Christ in full display, just as it is there, as God shows his true colors in Revelation 10 and verse 1, which we read in the morning service, to see God in full spectrum, to see the fellowship and the mystery of Christ, which has no end and is unsearchable by human ways, human standards, but now comes through the inspiration of rock revelation that prevails over the very gates and powers of hell, and it's for everyone. All men, Jewish, Gentile, reflective of Isaiah 56:7, that delivers us to the fullness of the promise of faith. For it says, that's the scripture that says, my house shall be a house of prayer for all people. So it was in his divine will. And even though Jesus was sent not but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel in his earthly pilgrimage, once following that, and once the old covenant had been fulfilled, it was time for a new beginning in Christ, and thus the Gentile church was born, in order that we would indeed have a house of prayer for all people. And the life of Jesus and mission of Paul puts us right there, puts us right into the center of the glory of God's wisdom. And Paul continues on in that thought, God who created all things by Jesus Christ. There you have it, which speaks of the vessel of humanity, that mantle of flesh, God took it upon himself, but while at the same time always remaining an omnipresent spirit, but by the comparison verses, when you cross-check that, because out of the mouth are two or three witnesses, let everything be established. It was a thought that Paul continued on in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, that delivers that the rock that they followed, speaking of the Exodus time, it always was Christ. 1400 some years, millennia and a half before the birth, it always was Christ, because that was always the idea in the mind of Almighty God. It was always going to be his expression on earth, even in the days of the Exodus generation. So we see God in the full glory of his existence. There's only the doctrine of oneness within Scripture, in continuation of what Paul had come to understand following his conversion. And before his conversion, he knew there was one God. He just didn't realize that Messiah had come. He'd been persecuting those people that did. But he got turned around. So it always was Christ in the making of the universe, in the leading of the Hebrew children out of the land of oppression that Egypt came to be. At that time, when a Pharaoh rose up who knew not Joseph, didn't have any acquaintance with these Hebrews, these Semitic people, there in the land of Egypt, where every shepherd or every Semitic tribes person, those sand ramblers and desert dwellers, every shepherd is an abomination to the Egyptians. But Joseph, out of the Abraham's loins there, so to speak, Joseph always knew his God who came into Egypt, and thus he became an instrument of salvation too. A pattern that would type itself. It would form a pattern of the life of the Savior, who would be sold out by his own, like Joseph was, but as one who was dead, or accounted as dead, in the case of Joseph, rose up and became the salvation of his people. So that provided a window into the heart and mind of Almighty God. Sent, and the story's there for all to see. It's put on full display. All the patterns, all the foundations, all the righteousness of what God does, it all serves to bring us together as one, to put these foreshadowings, these fulfillments together, to make one story out of it all. Over the long centuries, it's one story, even as there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Even as God is one, it's oneness all the way, from Alpha to Omega, from A to Z in the English language, from Genesis beginning to Revelation ending. It's there for all to see. Let's turn to St. John chapter will be 9. As Christ is the vine, given in King James language, or in other words, Christ is the trunk of the tree. You got to have the trunk of the tree there to support the branches. He is the tree of life itself. We have the seed within us where life has been implanted within, and that's evidence of itself. Just the fact that we live, that's strong evidence of itself that there is more to our being than meets the natural eye. How did the eye come together without a designer, with all the optical nerves and the complexity, and it turns the image upside down in the lens, and it gets into the brain, which turns it right side up, so we're not all trying to walk on the ceiling, how did God, that came about just through some random mutation, some cell embryos dividing and became light sensitive, and somehow it formed something so complex. And not only did it do that, but it did it in virtually every species of animal upon the face of the earth, not just humanity alone. It's a miracle from on high, and it speaks of the glory of God. As the Spirit of the Lord prepares the height and depth and length and the breadth of everything, puts himself on full display, puts everything that is to come, makes it the intent of his will to be known, so that we could reach a level of fullness of joy. And you couldn't reach a full level of the fullness of joy without the battle. As hard as it is, we don't like to suffer loss. I sure know I don't. We don't like to go through sickness. We don't like to go through trials, struggle of day-to-day living. We don't like to have enemies. But what it does do in the long run, it creates the peaceable fruits of the Spirit, shows us how to fight the battle, shows us the characteristics we need, and God knows that we have need of it, so we have this life in order to persevere and endure. First the obedience, then the victory. Now we've got the victory in Jesus' name, but victory in the sense of completion. All things prophetic come to pass, but first there has to be the obedience, then the victory, then the joy. So we're moving toward that goal in Jesus' name. Here in St. John chapter 9, now this instance, won't read the whole instance, it takes up quite a bit of the scripture. But it's taken from the miracle at the pool of Siloam, where the blind man was given sight. So in the middle of that story, in that account, St. John chapter 9, we'll pick it up at verse 29. We know that, and here come the critics out. We know that God spake unto Moses. As for this fellow, we know not from whence he is. Well, there's something going on here where you better consider things fast. There's something mighty miraculous about who they refer to as this fellow. We know that God spake unto Moses. Well, all things came by Jesus Christ. We see that from Ephesians 3. We see it from 1 Corinthians 10:4. The man answered and said unto them, the man who had heretofore had been blind, why herein is a marvelous thing that ye know not from whence he is, and yet he hath opened mine eyes. It's pretty good evidence on my account. I think there's something going on here. Now we know that God heareth not sinners, but if any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth. And of course, you know, you have to take that in the context. God came to seek and to save sinners. So the sinner's prayer is what saves us. But those who are inherently sinful and have no respect to the Almighty God, God's not going to be answering many of their prayers, which is what that refers to. All right, so verse 32 then. Since the world began, was it not heard that any man opened the eyes of one that was born blind? If this man were not of God, he could do nothing. Without me, you can do nothing. So, and I should point out also, just while we're here, I'll just read verse 38. And he said, Lord, I believe, and he worshiped him. What's it say after that? Jesus talks, I'm come for judgment into the world. If Jesus wasn't God, he could not accept the worship, because that was the main tenet of faith in the Old Testament. Worship goes to God alone. All right, the man worshiped Jesus. Jesus didn't upbraid him, didn't say, hey, I'm only the second person of a triune deity. That's not in there. And it's never going to be in there. He worshiped Jesus. It wasn't a violation of the law of Moses, because God was there in living form and Jesus received it. Amen. So you get bonus points for reading that scripture. Amen with me alone. All right. So within the man, with that evidence being shown, a desire for truth burned within that man's heart of gratitude. And it should have. You can all imagine what he felt like at that moment. And it brings to pass this saying, you know, how blind they are who refuse to see. It's basically what the man said who was blind before, but now had sight. As the miracle of mercy came to the one who would testify how blind these accusers were. Now, what absolute spiritual irony that is, that the man who was blind a few minutes before is telling them how blind they are, because they had natural sight all their lives, but they were the ones who were really blind. That's right. Wow. That's a lesson in there for everybody to take a hold of. The one who was blind but now can see had to point out an obvious fact to those who could see with their eyes but were blind to the miraculous events of the day of their visitation. Even so much, they were nasty tempered too. Sin nature's got a nasty side to it. They were even accusatory and judgmental to the man. You were born, as you read the whole account, you were born all together in sins, and you're teaching us, you know, and they cast him out of the worship place. Can you imagine? being that cruel? Can you imagine the spite within their souls? Not only were they not grateful because this upset the apple cart, they were the doctors of divinity of that time, and the political standing was theirs, and they loved the greetings in the marketplaces to be called rabbi of men, and all that tied into it. They couldn't even be grateful for this miracle done for one blind man from birth, but they even sought to put him down for it. You know what? Thank the Lord. We've all received benefits of prayer. If you get a miracle from the Lord, don't be surprised if people hate you for it. Things haven't changed that much. No wonder that our faith is pointed toward the doctrine of the heart, from what comes within, at the new covenant spoken of. I believe I mentioned it in the morning service from Jeremiah chapter 31. The verse is also 31 directly, but those scriptures surrounding there in Jeremiah 31. These supposed representatives of Moses of the law didn't have an ounce of appreciation or gratitude within them. Now, that didn't extend to all the people. We all know that certain groups here in America and other places in the world have tried to use these things for hatred and anti-Semitic behavior and so forth, being no better than Pharaoh of old and the Egyptians of old, who to every considered all the shepherds' race to be an abomination. Jesus was born out of the tribe of Judah, as it were, when you go through the descendancy that came on down. The 12 apostles were Jewish. The first church age messenger to the Gentile was Jewish. So that teaches us. So thank God for faith on whatever side of the ledger it comes on, whether Jewish or Gentile. Just thank God for faith. There were some that believed the early church was in and around Jerusalem and everybody in it was Jewish. So we don't neglect our roots, and we acknowledge that. So, but the attendant to our subject title, this is God's nature being put before all to see. But yet, he was rejected. Let's turn to, while we're in St. John, let's turn to the 19th chapter as we come to the crucifixion account. See that you refuse not him that speaketh from heaven. And of course, in very large measure, as to Jesus, it was rejected. But that's not cause for accusations or hatred either. Through this rejection of Christ, the word has come to the Gentiles. In Romans chapter 11, you can read all that you need to know about that subject is found in, excuse me, Romans chapter 11, because there was a purpose to it, to provoke Israel to a godly jealousy in the moment when they recognize their king, who Christ is. That's in Romans 11. All right, but here we are in St. John chapter 19, to the crossroads of our spiritual destiny, in Pilate's judgment hall, from the first verse. Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him, because of all the events which you're well aware of that lead up to this moment. And the soldiers platted a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe and said, "Hail, King of the Jews," spitefully, sardonically. And they smote him with their hands. Now, this is Christ putting himself out there for all to see. The humbleness, the obedience to the word, the fulfillment of a promise that was given to Abraham, fulfilled in Christ, he had to carry forth. He had to fulfill himself and show obedience to the utmost in order for the divine spirit of truth that God is, in order for that to come to the fullness of measure that was within the heart of the Almighty. That fact often gets overlooked. Christianity, it's for us to lift us up to full measure, but it's also for God to fill his divine destiny and everything that's within him to fulfill it to the last full measure of faith. So there he is. You can see him in your mind's eye. You know, these things, they get filmed, you know, in various programs that you can watch and so forth. But coming right off the page, I don't think anything surpasses that which comes off the page. Visual images, they're fine. I've watched a few myself. But when it comes off the page, and you can just see it with your heart and see it in your mind, there, it's all on display. All right, verse 4. Pilate therefore went forth again and saith unto them, Behold, I bring him forth to you, that ye may know that I find no fault in him. He doesn't look like a rebel or a zealot, was the word we often use there. That word zealot comes out of that time period. He wasn't a rebel against the Roman Empire in any political fashion. So I find no fault in him. Then came Jesus forth, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate saith unto them, Behold the man. Behold the man. Well, there he is for all to see. Behold the man. Barely clinging on to life in the physical sense. Beaten, bruised. Everything that Isaiah 53 said, wounded for our transgressions, all that. Look at him. There he is. There's the picture. Behold the man. He's there for all to see. And of course, Pilate thought this spectacle that, you know, he thought, at least in some measure, it was one he was directing, as if the power to rule was his. And of course, he could have no rule or authority except it was given to him for that moment from above. So any power he thought he had, that was an illusion. For there was a greater power at work than that of imperial Rome. There was a greater power at work than the ruling council of the Pharisees, the Sanhedrin is the historical name there. As Pilate's behavior was guided by his, a lot by hatred, because when you look through the whole history of Pilate, he had put down a few revolts in the Holy Land, and his hatred of these quarrelsome Jews and their insufferable religion that was so fine-tuned by the overinterpretation of the law of Moses, but nonetheless, what was just and holy and true was true. And these insufferable Jews whose religion was so hard to adapt to, as the Romans had spread their religion and throughout the Greco-Roman world and adapted it. And here these people were who believed in one God, so unlike the lands that the Caesars had subjugated and conquered. So hard to unify them and bring them together. Oh, he hated them. So here he is. Behold the man. There he is. This is what you've done. So Pilate's behavior and attitude, it's a curious mix of disdain and fear of revolt and the desire to keep things calm in the empire while appeasing the local populace and rulership at the same time. He was just befuddled by the whole mess. So here he is. I'll go along with it. Here he is. This is what you've done. As he was trying to ascertain what and where the real danger was to him personally, because he had to report back to Tiberius Augustus, who was Caesar at the time of the crucifixion. He had to report back to Caesar. So he just made a mock, in the end, he sort of just made a mockery of the whole thing. But yet, through it all, he was strangely troubled, and it affected him because his wife had had the dream that caused her to warn her husband about this man. You can find that in Matthew 27:19. But all that got swept, that bothered him, but it all got swept aside in the momentum of events that were unfolding. Some matters just have a life of their own, and this matter was foretold in Genesis 3:15 as to the birth of a Savior, and Psalms 22 contains his suffering. In the Psalm of the Cross, Psalms 22 does, and it had to be. It's foreseen and forsworn that God would follow through on his promise. But amid all that, as the turning point of all turning points, as the center of all destiny was at hand, which none understood, not even the 12 apostles. Nobody understood it except for the master himself. He knew exactly what was going on. He knew what it took. He had counted the cost. It would cost the blood of the cross in order to bring salvation to us. But he was the only one that understood it completely. But amid all that, we have this statement. Behold the man. There he is for all to see. Pilate knew he was being played. Sure, he knew that. He knew he was being set up. So he tried to wash his hands of the whole affair. But nonetheless, the statement stands out. Behold the man, for that's exactly what every single person in the world has to do. You have to behold the man. Who is this person? What do we do with this person who we call Christ? There he is, full display. The humbleness, the servitude, the obedience, it's all there. You have to see him and behold him for who he is, every person. And that was God's decision for Christ to be seen that way, as alone, beaten, bruised for our iniquities, enduring the suffering that by all rights should have been ours, as the chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. The chastisement of our peace. He suffered for our sake. So we see him as he is, obedient to the last full measure of sacrificial devotion. It's all there. It's all there for everyone to see, friend or foe. As God wanted to be seen this way, right? Or else he wouldn't have done it. He could have called 12 legion of angels to destroy the world and set him free. He wanted to be seen this way. He humbled himself. He stayed the course, stayed to his mission. In Jesus of Nazareth, he felt the human desire to be departed from him, such a trial. But how else to fulfill Scripture? As Jesus said there in those hours in Gethsemane. So he wanted to be seen this way. But that's not everything. He wanted to be seen in another way too. He wanted to be seen as triumphant. He wants to be seen as our soon coming king. He wants to be seen as faithful to the promise. He wants to be seen as arisen from the dead. He wants to be seen as ascended on high. He wants to be seen as lifted up upon the throne of heaven forevermore. You have to see him who he is in all aspects of God's glory. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapters 13. You'll recognize that, 1 Corinthians 13, the great charity chapter of 1 Corinthians 13. Though I speak with the tongue of men and angels, better to, if I do that and have not charity, which is Christian love, the bond of perfectness that love is, I'm like sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal, all noise and no substance. You've got to see them in full spectrum. It takes a lot of colors to make up what we see as white or clear light. Till you see it in the right way. The light in here looks white and clear, but if you break it down, put it through a reflecting glass, through a prism, then you can see all the colors that makes up that white and clear light. God is the light, and him is no darkness, but there are a lot of colors that go in to making him. So also do many aspects go into the nature of God to make his presence to be known. And Pilate, by the way, lest we forget about him, later on in Scripture he would say, "Behold your king," derisively. But the whole spiritual matter was in the seeing of Christ as king by the bringing to pass all that was written. Art thou a king then? Thou sayest it. You're saying it by fulfilling the scriptures that were written long ago that bring us to this moment. You're saying I'm king. And Pilate would literally say it on the cross, because the legend was, here's Jesus, King of the Jews, written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. So that inscription would be there. But you're saying I'm king because look what you're doing. All the things that are written are for this moment, for the right here and now. So you're saying I'm king by your actions. You're just a Gentile. You don't know these things, but you're bringing all things to pass through your actions and all things that are written. So to that end, we see God's purpose in mercy and fulfillment, but yet knowing there's more to come. So here at 1 Corinthians 13, this the rendering of love as being the core and at the crux of all eternal characteristics. We'll pick it up at verse 12. which says, "For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face." In other words, we don't know it all yet. We know in part, we prophesy in part. That which is verse 9 of this very chapter, which is why this reads the way that it does. All right? Our knowledge is partial, but thank God for what we do know. I know my Redeemer liveth. I know that. Amen. All right? And we will see him as a being of light or face to face. In whatever manner God manifests himself, we'll see him directly. So now I know in part. But then shall I know even as also I am known. Oh, we can know our God. And to be known of God, oh my goodness. What an honor and privilege. He knows your name. If you got a name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, he knows it. He knows it's in there. And now abideth faith, hope, charity. These three, because God reveals himself in threes. Faith and hope and charity, those are all aspects of love and the expectation of it. So he abides in those three, but the greatest of these is charity. So bless the Lord. So now we see. Behold the man. We shall see him as he is on that day of his appearing. He's there for all to see. And I don't know everything as yet. I haven't apprehended it all. Sometimes that's the word in King James language that's attributed to Paul in the translation from the Greek language. I haven't, excuse me, I haven't got a hold of it all yet. I don't know it all in full. There's more glory to follow before we shall know him as he is. But what I do see, I see. What I do know, I know. As faith and hope, as the expectation of faith and charity abide together, and even as God is one. And faith and hope and love form up together to describe the divine nature of God that was set in place before the Genesis 1-1 beginning. So God's putting himself on display. Now, things that God calculates is according to, God moves in mysterious ways. But you can always know the nature of what he is doing. We may not all understand every chess move that gets made on the board. But we know that there's purpose behind it. That's what Ecclesiastes 3 says. There's a time and a purpose to everything that happens under the heaven in the mind of the Almighty God and the living Savior. So it's all there. So we may not understand everything that God does, but we do understand his nature, and that's to bring forth life. Amen. And love through his name, and to bring salvation. And if one has the faith to move mountains, you know, as 1 Corinthians 13 speaks of, when you take the whole segment of Scripture into account, if you had faith to move mountains, what avail is it unless you're guided by the principles of love? Amen. It's worthless without it. So thank God. Thank God that we're not accounted as worthless in Jesus' name. And what we see so far is what God has led us to. What we see in Scripture, it's what God's revealed. He's put himself there for all to see. And not by the hand of man is this done. God used men to help spread the word because the gospel was written for us as a race of human beings. It's written for us, so God uses human vessels. But his word is displayed in what is written, and it's revealed in what he has promised. In Psalms chapter 17, Psalm 17 is God makes his word true because it always was true. It always was true from ever. Truth is a fixed point in time, and boy, does that get obscured in this world. Truth has become, not to me, but out there in the world at large, truth has become whoever screams the loudest and the longest, that gets accounted as truth just by repetition. Well, from the beginning, God's been saying the repetitions and the babblings of the heathen are vain. They think they're going to be heard for much speaking. God doesn't hear truth just because it's loud and long. He hears truth because truth is a fixed point. And it always has been, it is now, and always will be true. no matter what tries to obscure it. It doesn't change. God doesn't change his nature. He's the spirit of truth. How could truth change? It doesn't change. It's always the same. And Christ is the yesterday, today, and forever. He's the same, and his years fail not. So we pray that the Lord of the harvest sends us his blessings so that we can be of use in his will as truth abides and remains within us on a forever basis. Here at Psalms 17, from the sixth verse, we read, I have called upon thee, for thou wilt hear me, O God. What a message is in there. What power there is in just a short, simple statement like that. Incline thine ear to me, which isn't, we're not giving God instructions. It's a plea. It's a plea. Lord, I know this is in your will. Incline thine ear unto me and hear my speech. Show thy marvelous loving kindness. O thou that savest by thy right hand them which put their trust in thee from those that rise up against them. Keep me as the apple of the eye. I made a brief reference to it in the morning service. Here it is written, one of the times that phrase is used, I believe five times in Scripture. This is one. Keep me as the apple of the eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings from the wicked that oppress me, from my deadly enemies who compass me about. Well, the Lord heard this plea of David, brought it to completion of Christ. Christ was the answer to this plea. Christ is the answer to all requests to shield me and to guide me, deliver me from those things that are evil. Christ was the power of God's right hand. The power was in Christ. Amen. So it all comes to completion to him. And it's the Christ is the answer of all time to the righteous. His name is always the answer. And marvelous loving kindness came to us in living form, in person. The attributes of eternity, they're found in a living, breathing, expressive form, walking and talking amongst us. How about that? Isn't that terrific? Truth took on human form. The wisdom of the Almighty God showed itself, walked and talked amongst us. And this desire to be kept as the apple of his eye, that's what was accomplished even as Pilate was saying, behold the man. Look at him. See him for all that he is. Turned out to be a lot different than Pilate thought. Turned out to be a lot different than what the accusers thought. Even the disciples weren't fully aware of all the things that were going on. But this pivotal moment of time is so that we could see Christ as he is. Humbled, beaten, bruised, but yet obedient, and lifted up to defeat the very powers of hell itself. Got to see him for all he is. Behold the man indeed. Seen, he became the perfect sacrifice for sin. And seen not just at that moment of time of which these scriptures were inscribed and tell of, but all the way down through the corridors of time right up to this day and age. Right here, right now, you got to see him for who he is, as God has given us all his blessings from above. Let's stand and pray. Thank the Lord. Brothers and sisters can come up. Thank the Lord for his word. It rises amongst us and disappoints all the work of the enemy. Brings us life and that more abundantly in Jesus' name. Thank the Lord. We had a few rain showers of the natural sort in the morning service. But thank the Lord for the showers of blessing, which is on Green Book, page 230. Showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops around us are falling. Thank the Lord for the mercies that we do and get that help us along, sustain us, help us get through the famine of this world. But for the showers we plead. We plead for more blessings, and that more abundantly through the name of Jesus, who always was the rock. The children of the Exodus, that rock was always Christ.
That's right.
His word is one. His person is one. His name is one forever. and we rely upon him for all our needs. As we bow our heads and pray, and Sister Patty and Sister Miriam may play through as they will. Thank you, Lord, Father, for those showers of blessing that we plead for. Father, you know we have need of it. But first the obedience, first the struggle, Father God, first the battle that makes us soldiers in Jesus' name, and then the victory, Father God, and then the celebration. So, Father, as we hear the trumpet sound that calls us together and assembles us together, gets us ready to fight the battle and celebrate the victory and get moving in Jesus' name toward that goal of life, and that more abundantly through your name, Father, we thank you. We offer up our praises, Father. We thank you, Lord, that we can be part of this old, old story, which is always new within our spirit every time we take hold of it and let it work mightily within us. And Father, we thank you for those that are sorrowing, Father God, in the loss, Father, in times of despair, Father God, that the world would try to put on us. We thank you for the victory to show in those times as well. Father, we thank you for your healing and saving grace. We thank you for your intercessor's arm that's brought salvation unto himself as we behold you for all that you are and see your holiness displayed in full spectrum, Father, by the light of this word which shows us the ways of life. Father, we thank you for all your blessings now and forevermore through the name and faith of Jesus Christ, in which we put all our hope, all our prayers, all our being into. Father God, in that blessed name, the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
Well, thank the Lord. Well, thank the Lord for the blessings. Be very glad for them. There will be showers of blessings.
It's in the green book, 230, page 230.
There shall be showers of blessings. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessings, showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, for the showers we plead. There should be showers of blessing, precious reviving again. Over the hills and the valleys, sound of abundance of rain. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need.
It should be on page 189 in the green.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.